there. Have you had anorexia for a long time and you finally decided to eat unrestrictedly and live unrestrictedly, and you're having a little bit of a fear problem and other things are coming up too? Okay, well, watch the following video, like or subscribe, and peace. Hello there, my name is Billie Juliana. I'm 49 years old and I have a 40-year history of dealing with anorexia nervosa. And I'm currently following the recovery methods espoused by Tabitha Farrar, Kayla Rose Katecki, and Elisa Orris. And today I just wanted to jump on camera to do another casual video and just send a little message. Okay, so the basic message is, how are things going since I have started unrestricted eating and unrestricted living the last 10 days or so? Now, I want to preface all of this by saying, if you don't know much about my history, I will just go over it briefly and give a little background. Yes, I do have a 40-year history of anorexia, and that has been a big schlep. And I've done a lot of treatment over the years, a lot of treatment, and none of it has worked. And then 2.5 years ago, I ran across the recovery methods propounded by Tabitha Farrar, Kayla Rose Katecki, and Elisa Orris. And I was like, aha, I think this is the key out of the enslavement that I've been in for all these years. Now, this enslavement that I've been in for all these years has had its purpose, and I'll go over part of that in this video, but I want to be liberated from it because it has gotten really old, it has gotten really tiresome, and it is really overcome my life to the point that I've only lived a half life. So I want to be liberated from that. And I think that these methods of recovery propounded by these women are the methods, or really there's only one method, and that is unrestricted eating for life, prolonged period of rest, and no more body weight suppression. Okay, so I started working with one of these women as a coach 2.5 years ago, and it took me a while to actually get into my brain what unrestricted eating meant and what rest meant. And so it was only about a month's worth of resting and unrestricted eating, and my body weight shot up, and it went up so quickly, and I not fully rewired, well, not really even rewired much at all, fully, forget that. I'd only partially rewired anything in my brain. And so this higher weight that I didn't even know exactly how much I weighed, but it just felt unbearable. I was at a higher body weight than I'd ever been in my life, and I was just a different person, or so I seemed, and I just froze and I couldn't handle it. And then I just stayed in quasi-recovery, which is not really recovery at all, by the way, for over a year. And I started this YouTube channel about 5 months ago as a way to pull myself out of quasi-recovery because I knew I needed to do something. I gained enough knowledge working with this eating disorder coach to know that what I was doing wasn't good, that it was only prolonging the anorexia and not helping my recovery at all. So I started this YouTube channel as a way to go over all the reasons why I stay stuck, and go over what it means for an older person to be in anorexia recovery using these methods of recovery. And I've done a lot of unrestricted eating during that process that I've been doing YouTube. And then I pulled back and gone, wait, this is too fast. No, I can't do this. And then I'll do unrestricted eating again. And then I'll pull back and go, wait, no, this is too much. I can't do this. And so it's just ended up being the same old song and dance, and that is eating and restricting and eating, restricting. And so finally I was like, you know what? I'm doing a YouTube channel. I need to walk the talk. If I'm going to be representing people who are older, I need to walk the talk. And so about 10 days ago, I went back all in. I know for sure now what unrestricted eating looks like for me because I had mental hunger 24/7. This is despite the fact that I've gained 40 pounds. I still have huge mental hunger, and it's just a product of having been starved for so many years. So I'm going to be looking at having mental hunger for a long time. And right now, my unrestricted eating would ideally be 24/7. Now, I can't do that 24/7, but I can pack in as much as I can, and that's what I've been doing. So I knew that going in with the all-in, unrestricted eating, full-on resting approach, yet again, that my eating disorder would just start shouting at me. And I was kind of like, heaven with your best shot. Yeah, exactly. Hit me with your best shot and I'm gonna hit you right back. I just knew that I could handle whatever the eating disorder was gonna throw at me because, after all, I know a lot about my eating disorder and I know a lot about the ways in which it serves me and in the way in which it works in my brain, and so I can handle it. And I knew that the anxiety spike would be the first thing that I was gonna sense. I was gonna start eating a lot and I was gonna have huge anxiety spike. And guess what? That happened. And guess what? I was like, there it is, the anxiety spike. But I'm fearless, except for the fact that I went back to the internet and started watching so many more recovery videos and reading a lot many more recovery blogs. And that is just because I needed that extra support. With that super huge feeling of anxiety and fear, that's really hard for one person, or at least me, to take on alone. So I need extra support during this time, especially after I have gained so much weight already and I'm already in a normal BMI zone and I'm eating all this food and resting. This doesn't seem logical to me, or at least not to my eating disorder brain. I forget the fact that I've tortured myself for 40 years, but whatever, I need the extra support. So I've gone to the internet, read more recovery blogs, and watched a lot more recovery YouTube videos. This has been very, very helpful. But I want to add one caveat to that, and that is when I read the comments that are below the videos or below the blogs even, and I read the comments because I feel like a lot of times people have something really, really cool and knowledgeable and experienced to say in their comments. There are a lot of smart people out there who can add to the support that I'm getting from the particular video I'm watching by making comments. So I usually read them, but every now and then there will be a comment that says, you know, hey, this method of recovery didn't work for me and this is why. And while that's valid for that person to say, for whatever they're going through, for me, it goes into the anorexic circuitry in my brain, and my disease says, see, you shouldn't be doing this method of recovery because you're going to end up unhappy. It doesn't work. And so I just need to spot how any form of data that is coming into my brain can be used against me, especially if I perceive it as something that is negative or something that is counter to this method of recovery. And so my disease will seize upon that and turn me away and lead me right back to restriction. Now, I've spotted this and I'm already like, okay, this comment isn't helpful. So I'm gonna work on rewiring how I interpret data that's coming in and what I need to do for myself, which is consistently eat unrestrictedly and rest. That's the bottom line. So anything else that's gonna derail me from that isn't helpful and I'm not gonna pay attention to it. Working in a coal mine, going down, down, down. Okay, so the next thing that I found that is kind of a weird thing, but you know what? My eating disorders coach actually just covered it on her YouTube channel because someone wrote to her with a question that said, you know what? I've taken time off for recovery, but I've got to head back to school. I've got to go back to college. And I'm wondering how that's going to play out. I feel like I have all this permission and all this time to rest and actually honor all my mental hunger, but when I go back to the university, I'm afraid I'll be triggered back into doing what I was doing when I was at the university. And so my eating disorders coach took this on and she was like, you know, this happens a lot because as a culture, we are ingrained with the idea of, you know, rest on the weekend and then having a work week. And then of course, when you're at university, you're working all the time. And we're basically just ingrained with, we have to do it this way in order to manage whatever we're doing, our work or our school or et cetera. And she said, well, we don't have to do it that way. We have to realize that we can go back to university, but we do things differently. And we just train our brains to do a different route. Even as we are doing our studies or whatever, we take a different route and we basically keep eating unrestrictedly and rest as much as possible. And I am in complete agreement with that. But I think it's a little bit oversimplified for me. And I'm not saying anything bad about my coach. She's just going pretty quickly here, as I'm trying to do, although this is turning out to be long. But I just want to say that for me, there's a little bit something more esoteric going on there, a little bit more psychological. And I want to bring this up because I think this is important, maybe for the older people who have had the disease for so long and who are so invested in living anorexically, even as much as we hate it. And that is the idea of the work week, that time when we're more busy, the Monday through Friday schedule, and even sometimes on the weekend, of course, but when we're more busy, when I am more busy, when I have more things to do, when I have tasks to complete and people to interact with and all of this kind of stuff, those things are a way of feeding my brain that my anorexia perceives as actually being fed, so that the mental hunger is completely supplanted by the busyness that is out there. In other words, you can just kind of call it distraction from my mental hunger, but it's a little bit deeper than that. It's like my anorexia is saying, okay, you've gotten your feeding for today. You don't need to eat as much. It's just this weird way in which the anorexia is working. And I'm figuring this out because I really, really struggled with going from a weekend to a Monday and eating unrestrictedly on a Monday and then Tuesday, Wednesday. I struggle with that. And so I'm sitting here thinking, you know what? I think that part of it is because anorexia just takes everything it can in order to keep my world circumscribed and to keep me from eating and actually liberating myself from this little bubble that I've been living in. And so it actually takes weird ways in which data comes into my brain and uses that as food. I know that sounds strange, but that's what's going on. So if I were a person that was going to a university, I would probably not be eating at all if I'm sitting there in my anorexic brain. That is certainly what happened to me when I did go to college. I never ate through college because I was getting so much information that was feeding me. And while you can say, it was actually stress and stuff like that, and you were just falling back on your anorexia to help prop you up, I'm like, there's something else there going on too. I had a lot of stuff coming in that was feeding my brain, and my anorexia was using that as a way of getting nourished without nourishing my body. So I have to be really aware of this sort of psychological component of my disease and be like, you know what? I need to make sure that even though there may be more things coming in and more to do, more to engage in during a work week, I need to make sure that I am eating unrestrictedly during the work week and having the same amount of food that I have on the weekend and in more restful periods and the same types of food, and not to change anything, because it is very, very hard to make that transition from a more leisure time to a busier time when you're trying to eat unrestrictedly and you have the stupid disease in your brain. All right, so thank you for bearing with me on the esotericness there, but I do think that it is kind of important to go over all the ways in which my brain, which is pickled with anorexia, works.
Gotta feel like hell tonight.
Okay, so the next point is edema. And I just want to say that, look, anybody who is eating a lot of extra food all at once is going to have water retention. This is just a normal thing that happens to the human body. I don't understand all the biology behind it, but I have a rudimentary idea of it. And edema is just a normal process that happens when I put extra food into my body. Now, if it becomes pernicious to the point that I can't walk, or it's painful to walk, or I can't grip my hand, or if it lasts super long, like over a year or whatever, I do need to see a doctor about it, because that would be outside the bounds of normal and I would need some medical help with it. But this kind of edema that I'm talking about, the puffiness and stuff like that, that's pretty much within the range of normal. And so my anorexia, though, is sitting there going, water retention, bad, water retention, bad. And you know what? You're doing YouTube. And if you appear on camera with all this puff in your face, people are gonna get really, really scared, and they're gonna go click off, unsubscribe, run fast, and head for the hills, and you're going to be sitting there with your puffy face talking to no one. And I'm sitting here going, okay, well, if that's the case, if I lose a bunch of subscribers because I'm puffy, then I guess I won't do YouTube because my recovery is more important to me. I'm sad and sorry to say sayonara to YouTube because I wanted to be out there for older people and to represent the older people who are going through anorexia recovery. But you know what? It's worth shutting down the whole channel in order to achieve full recovery if I have a chance at it. So I'm gonna take that chance and run. So metaphorically, by the way, I'm resting. So edema does not need to bother me. I'm just gonna say that. It does always feed the anorexic circuitry in my brain. Any kind of body reaction that I have will feed the anorexic circuitry in my brain, and my anorexia will start coming up with all these reasons why I need to restrict, and edema is one of them. Another one, though, is... sugar spikes. And because my body is asking for something so specific, and that is baked sweet goods, I really don't even want candy and chocolate bars and stuff. I want dense baked sweet goods like cake and brownies and donuts and things like that. And actually, the specificity of what my body is asking for is a good clue that my body is needing it for a specific reason. Because if I was just, you know, going for a sugar high, I'd be wanting, you know, candy and things like that. But I don't want that. I want these specific things. So there's a reason for this, and my body is needing these foods for a specific reason. I have to be really honorable about that. But you know what? My anorexia takes the reaction that my body has once I ingest these foods and runs with it. It takes any data that comes into my brain actually and runs with it. But this is one of them, and that is after I eat a load of sugar, which I'm doing often, I either feel like I need to go directly to bed or I get really jittery. And so my anorexia seizes upon these reactions and says, your body is not handling sugar well. Your body is going to break down and you're going to get diabetes. And this is tough for me because it is true that diabetes runs rampant in my family. So my family genetics are predisposed to diabetes. And I personally have a blood sugar that runs rather high. It's pre-diabetic in medical terms. So I do worry about running the risk of diabetes, but I have to say, what choice do I have? If I want to liberate myself from this circumscribed and shrunken life that I have been living, if I want to get to this place of liberty, what choice do I have if my body is asking for these specific sweet foods? I can't make substitutions. That is just restriction. I can't go eat an apple and a sweet potato and say, okay, I've eaten my sweet stuff, because my body will be like, I feel deprived. I didn't get what I asked for. So I have to honor my body. And so that means running the risk of diabetes. And I just have to go with it and quiet my anorexia down and quiet my brain down and say, you know what? You can go over here and sit over here and I'm going to eat my sweets. Okay, so that covers the points that have popped up initially here, initially in the first 10 days or so of going back to eating unrestrictedly and living unrestrictedly. Believe me, there are going to be tons more things that anorexia is going to bring up to throw ringers in my way. But I just got to say, I've got to roll with every one of them. That is, counteract everything that anorexia says with them and roll on with my recovery and keep eating unrestrictedly and living unrestrictedly. You know, that may mean I appear on camera puffy. It may mean that I run the risk of diabetes. And for right now, it may mean that I'm uncomfortable and fearful all the time. It may mean that I'm always watching recovery videos. What's wrong with all that, you know? In comparison to this over here, this awful life of enslavement that I've been living, this temporary period of discomfort is just fine. And you know what else? The baked sweet goods taste really good, and I have enjoyed a lot of them, and I've enjoyed a lot of the resting that has gone along with that. So having said that, I recommend to you, try unrestricted eating full on resting. Please take care and peace.